Okay. So now moving on from sediment, same system, similar kind of system with one significant difference is soil air interface. Now soil air interface is much closer to us because we have interface with it directly. Sediment water interface is somewhere down there. So lot of times sediment water problems are not even seen after until several decades after it is done. Soil air you can see it very quickly for two reasons. One, there is groundwater sitting right next to it, so it may reach the groundwater quickly. So let us say that there is a contamination here. Why are we worried about soil air exchange? If there is a contamination sitting here inside soil, or there is a contamination sitting right on top. So we did examples in the beginning of this mass transfer exercise that we said that there is impervious land surface. The chemical is dumped on a road or a surface which is not porous. It sits there and it evaporates from the pure chemical from there. But if it is not impervious, it's soil, it percolates just the way chemicals into the sediment percolate over a period of time, and then it then reaches a state where all of it is pure chemical is either sitting there or pure chemical is all gone and then it's adsorbed. Then it starts reversing, it starts going out. Everything we have done in the sediment case applies here. The model, we use the same model, this domain equation will still be, it will just be rho A2 1 instead of rho A2 2, dA 3 1 divided by RA 3 1 into dou A rho square 1 by dou Z square. Instead of sediment water interface, we are using soil air interface. Significant difference here, only difference here is the dA 3 2, dA 3 1 is dA 1 multiplied by epsilon 1 raised by 10 by 3 divided by epsilon t square. We do this because unlike the sediment, the soil may contain moisture, and if it contains moisture, diffusion coefficient in the vapor phase for air will depend on what is this. So epsilon total is epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2. If you think that epsilon 2 is negligible, you can assume epsilon t equals epsilon 1, and therefore that equation will become dA 1 into epsilon raised to 4 by 3. But until that point, if you think that it is not valid, then you have to do this. Also RA 3 1 is now epsilon 1 plus KA 3 1 star into rho 3 1. This is the bulk density of the soil, and KA 3 1 is the partition constant of a chemical with the soil. Now here you have to consider all the usual things, that if the soil is wet, the partition constant is based on KOC FOC divided by Henry's constant. If it is dry, then it is something else, it is higher. Okay. So it's the same rules apply here. So the retardation constant, retardation factor can change with time, can change with this is something that happens in soil. So this is a function of the moisture, this is the moisture content, and then this is also, then moisture content is a function of time. Moisture content can change. It can change during a day, it can change in months or weeks, years, everything. Okay. So what will happen now? If I solve this equation, same boundary conditions, I can have the boundary conditions are diffusion is happening in the air and this is convection. So the boundary condition at the surface will be at z equals to 0, can be Ka can be Ka 1 3 multiplied by rho A 1 at z equals to 0 minus rho A 1 infinity equals minus of dA 3 1 dou rho A d rho A 1 by rho Z at z equals to 0. Same thing, all the same analysis for sediment applies here, except it is air, for vapor concentration, there is a continuum there. So this is a mass transfer coefficient at the air soil interface, the convective mass transfer coefficient, okay, same. But the main equation, the retardation factor, can change with time because theta is Ka31 is a function of time. So Ka31 is a function of theta, which is a function of time. So therefore, Ka31 can change. Okay, what will happen if Ka31 changes? What is the consequence of Ka31 changes? The initial condition is rho A10. Just like what we did previously, is rho 31 divided by Ra2 Ra31. What will happen if the partition constant changes? So if I have two scenarios, if I have dry soil and wet soil, wet soil means 10% moisture is there, still diffusion in pore air is happening, yeah. So still diffusion in pore vapor is happening, what do you expect the difference between dry soil and wet soil? If I am doing flux calculation versus time, one of them will be higher when you dry and wet. Which one will be higher? With the dry. Why?
Number of resistant surfaces.
What is the highest flux? What is the highest flux? Time T0 is the highest flux. What will it be? What is the value of the highest flux? K. Na time T is equal to 0, or highest flux will be Ka13 multiplied by rho A10. So which one of these two, for which one of the two cases, dry or wet? Ka13 does not change, it does not care whether the soil is dry or wet, it is going to be what it is because it depends on whatever is happening in the wind air side. Assuming that air side does not change, what is changing in this equation? Does anything change if the sediment is, soil is dry or wet? I have written here, I have written it here. Ra31 is changing. Ra31 is higher or lower for dry? For dry. What is Ra31? Ra31 is here. I think you have forgotten, it is time to recall. Ka31 star as a function of theta. It is like this, yeah, this is dry, this is wet, this is damp, somewhere in between it is called damp, yeah. So now if Ka31 is high, very dry sediment, Ka31 is high, what does this mean? Ka31 is high, rho A20 is WAT into rho 31 divided by Ka31 star, which means for dry sediment, rho A10 will be smaller, smaller, much smaller. So rho A10 for dry is much smaller than rho A10 wet, because Ka31 star dry is greater than Ka31 star wet. If you put this into the transport model, you can predict what will happen to the flux Na versus T. So let us say we start with a wet season, it is wet, it is damp. So now let us say at December there is an agricultural field where there is a pesticide which is releasing, you will see a flux like this, flux is decreasing as a function of inverse square root of time. Then we start at, sorry, we start at January, this is March, we go to May, we go to July, October. What happens in May? By May, the soil starts drying very rapidly, okay. Then what you may see is this flux will drop down really low, because now we are moving from a wet regime to a dry regime, it is going here. So, the flux is dropping down because there is more space is available in this thing, all the pore components, chemical in the pore now leaves the pores and goes on to solid. There is nothing much in the pore, driving force is very small. Simply this is smaller, when this is smaller everything goes down, no driving force are all smaller. Flux goes down, you will see very low flux, nothing coming up. Then July, there is rain. And it jumps back up to almost its previous level as though it has not changed, and it continues going down, okay. So, this happens cyclically, this is one of the things that happens in season. In India it is very prominent, you can see it very clearly, you can feel it, you can smell, which is one of the reasons why you smell. Okay. This is application of the transport model in emissions in reference to soil. So, I will just leave today's session with one small aspect of, so we are talking about all this. So, we have talked about K12, we have talked about K21, we have talked about K23, we have talked about Ka13. They are all mass transfer coefficients. To get a correlation for mass transfer coefficients, you need to, how do you get a correlation for mass transfer coefficients? You need some estimate of the driving force and then you need flux. So, any Ka equals flux divided by the driving force. How do you measure flux? Say in flux across sediment water interface or flux across air soil, these things. How do you measure flux? What is the simple, any simple technique? Concentration, driving force. How do you measure concentration driving force? You just measure the concentration in whatever distance that you want from water, air. You take a sample of water, you take a sample of air, analyze it by whatever techniques you already learnt in class. You take sample of sediment, take sample of soil, take sample of air, analyze. This is how you do it, there is nothing else, no other way of doing it. So, all the driving force measurements are done by actual core in soil and sediment. You take a core and you find out where, what is the contamination, and then you find out what is the concentration. You take an air sample, you take a water sample, you get concentrations in the bulk water, okay. So, that is done. How do you measure flux? Okay. So, one way to do it is simply by mass balance using the box model. So, simply conservation of the mass balance is in minus out, or out minus in is flux, or in minus out is flux, depending on which direction it is. Out minus in is flux means it is coming into the system, in minus out is it is going out of the system. So, either way it is by mass balance is what you can do. So, in a river for example, you can say Q multiplied by rho A2 in rho A2 out minus Q rho A2 in divided by area will be the flux. This continuously you are doing. In the chemical analysis series that you have seen, how many measurements can you do like this? in the module on chemical analysis that we have done, in all the organic chemicals that you have seen, what does this imply? Q into rho A2 out minus Q into rho A2 in. As I have written this equation, what does it imply? What is the assumption in terms of measurement? Huh? I have written rho A2 out minus rho A2 in. Is this this is a concentration of the chemical that is coming in and going out. What is the assumption here? Huh? I can't.
Mass
is conserved. What is the other thing that is assumed in this?
No reaction.
No, I think we are on the wrong track totally. Anyway, so this is a steady state system we are looking at. There is nothing else happening. No reaction. No accumulation is happening. Lot of times you would like to do this when you write it like this in terms of Q. You have to collect the entire mass of what is coming out, and that will give you so Q into rho A2, this is L cubed by T into MA by L cube. It gives you the rate of material that is coming out, and divided by the area, that gives you flux. Lot of times if you can do it continuously, you can measure this as a function of time quickly, as and you will giving it is giving you instantaneous flux. Okay. But many of the chemicals you see, don't have probes. We are not able to do that. Just like the way we collect air sample through a tube, you have to collect a lot of this sample. You have to collect a large volume of the water, and then whatever is the concentration, rho A2 out minus rho A2 in. In other words, we have to collect a large amount of water, delta T into rho A2 out minus rho A2 in, divided by A will give you the flux value, because you are unable to measure instantaneously. You have to collect for a period of time, for 5 hours, large volume. Then you extract the large volume, you will get a mass of chemical that is in the volume. And that divided by the area, yeah, and the delta T, yeah, delta T will come here, and the time interval. So this will give you volume. Is essentially this numerator divided by the area and the time interval, yeah. So this will give you flux. This is a time average flux. The flux is not an instantaneous value. It, in this case, it's a time average flux. You can't get one value at one particular time, that is not possible in this case. Okay. So there are other complications to flux measurement. I will show you some images on Tuesday. I will stop here.